We are now joined by Attorney Domingo Cayosa, the President of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. Good morning, Attorney Cayosa. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Good morning, Mike, at magandang umaga to your viewers.
First, let me get your thoughts about the recent order of the President to arrest those who refuse to be vaccinated. You've made your position clear. There is no law as yet punishing refusal to be vaccinated. Therefore, there's no legal basis for the arrest. Yet you have Chief Presidential Legal Counsel Salvador Panelo saying there's no need for a law because we have constitutional provisions on the right to health. Can you actually use these constitutional provisions to make arrests for those who refuse to get vaccinated?
No. That position adds to the confusion of our countrymen, but for lawyers like us, including the Justice Secretary and the spokesperson of the President, another lawyer, Professor Harry Roque, they've already clarified that without a law punishing the refusal to be vaccinated, there is no way anybody can order the arrest of these persons.
Mm-hmm. Now, as we pointed out earlier, Panelo's position is contradictory to those taken by Justice Secretary Minado Guevara, who share your view, and Presidential Spokesperson Harry Roque, who said a law is needed before making arrests on this issue. So we now have a situation where the government's top lawyers are not necessarily in sync when it comes to legal interpretation. And this is not the first time. Panelo said before that quarantine violators could be charged with murder. Roque disagrees. What do you make of this? One reporter asked, shouldn't they have their own group chat?
That's very true. Or perhaps they are assigned different functions. But it doesn't help at all in the effort of government in our country to encourage compliance with the COVID-19 protocols. The confusion, the contradictions, the urong sulong makes it more difficult to compel obedience. And that's why it's very important for anyone in leadership to get their acts together. Perhaps Secretary Panelo is speaking from a point of view of the power of the state. But even that power, even the police power, must be based on law. You just cannot leave a general provision of the Constitution and make it applicable to a particular case.
So, Attorney Cuyos, in your view, you said that there should be a delineation of functions. In your view, who among the three lawyers should be speaking about legal interpretation of you know, whatever the president says? And I mean, you know, that there's a need to interpret what the president says. Doesn't it say something, you know, about the state of legal interpretation?
Well, if it is a statement to the public, I would venture to say that it should be the spokesperson of the president. If it pertains to official matters, not necessarily for public consumption, it is the Department of Justice Secretary. The Presidential Legal Counsel's job is to advise the president in private. So he may be right, he may be wrong, but when these are made policy statements or orders made in public, if ever there's any correction to be made, necessarily it has to be the spokesperson because he's the one speaking to the country as a whole.
So, Attorney Cayosa, you said in private. Are you suggesting that Secretary Panelo should communicate privately with the president and not communicate it publicly, his views on any particular legal issue?
But I think he does communicate with the president. That's his job. He has access to the president. But I don't think it is wise that after the spokesperson of Malacañang himself has already corrected or clarified that anyone else in the government would still speak about it publicly because important, essential in leadership and management is unity of command. There should only be one position on major and important decisions.
Attorney Cayosa, how are authorities and the public supposed to take arrest orders coming from the president? He previously ordered the arrest of those who are not properly wearing masks and village leaders in areas where super spreader events take place. Now, we know only a court can issue arrest warrants. How do we avoid confusion coming from statements made by the president?
Well, we can avoid the confusions underground if even before they're issued, they're well processed and vetted. And only one should be speaking. And I think that has been done by the president in some other issues. But in this particular case, it seems like there are many within his top lieutenants and cabinet secretaries speaking at the same time and the same topic. So, but realistically also, at the ground level, many law enforcers, including the LGU officials, also know the law. So they temper and they are cautious about jumping and obeying this. It is also known to many of us, including especially in government, that the president has this habit of hyperboles and exaggeration, which he himself and his top cabinet members admit and declare. So they take it with a grain of salt. But unfortunately, there might be some up there who just heard it in the news. It was not clarified. It was not meant to be that way. They might act on it. And that's when the injury or the damage starts happening. We hope we can avoid that by consistent, clear, and well-vetted public statements.
Attorney Cayosa, does the president have any obligation at all to consult his legal advisors before he speaks? Secretary Guevara said the president seeks his legal opinion only when he finds it really necessary. But we've seen statements, off-the-cuff statements made by the president, and you have his top legal advisors trying to justify his every statement.
Well, it is not necessary for the president to consult any of his advisors. He's the chief executive, and he has the last call. But it would be wise also for him to consult them. But, you know, he's also a lawyer. And as they oftentimes explain away, he didn't mean it as we understand it or as lawyers understand it. Perhaps he issues them as a politician, as a father, or perhaps an executive, or perhaps out of frustration or to emphasize a point. But that is for those who are close to him and who know the background. But for many Filipinos, it alarms them. And unfortunately, sometimes if they are immediately executed, prejudice and damage is done at the ground level. And that's where the problem lies.
Mm-hmm. On another issue, the President and Secretary Panelo again raising the issue of non-publication of the Rome Statute in claiming that the International Criminal Court has no jurisdiction over the Philippines. Secretary Roque never mentions this point, instead arguing on subject matter jurisdiction. So in your view, does the ICC have jurisdiction over alleged extrajudicial killings from 2011 to 2019? And can the Philippines invoke sovereignty to say we will not cooperate?
But one, it is clear in the Rome Statute, which the Republic of the Philippines initially signed, that the ICC has jurisdiction, even if a country withdraws from it, acts and omissions that may constitute war crimes or crimes against humanity or genocide committed before the withdrawal are still within the jurisdiction of ICC. Secondly, the claim of sovereignty is not availing, because what is who is accused here? It's not the Republic of the Philippines. These are individuals, private and government individuals who are being charged. So it's not really a matter of sovereignty. It's a matter of personal defense on the part of those who are charged.
All right. Attorney Cayosa, lastly, there's this talk about the president running for vice president. And you have heard Attorney Christian Monsod, one of the framers of the 1987 Constitution, say this cannot be allowed, or this is not allowed under the Constitution based on the intent of the Constitution. Now, in your view, can President Rodrigo Duterte be the next vice president?
But if you look, that may be the opinion and the view of one of the commissioners, because Attorney Monsod was a commissioner of the CONCOM. But unfortunately, if you look at the letter of the Constitution, it says not eligible for any re-election. And re-election means you run for the same office. And if you look at the records of the Constitutional Commission, there was nothing there that said during the discussion that this applies to the position of vice president. So, in strict interpretation of the law, it would seem that there is no prohibition for a past president of the republic to run for any other position except the presidency.
So, Attorney Cayosa, you don't agree with the position that some have taken that the line not eligible for re-election or shall not be, oh yeah, not eligible for any re-election, that's not, it's not qualified by the previous line saying the president and the vice president shall be elected by the direct vote of a people for a term of 6 years. You don't think that that's a qualifier for this line about re-election?
Yes, I don't think so, because that line includes the president and the vice president. And if you look at the succeeding provisions under vice presidency, the vice president can actually seek re-election. So it's obvious that the any re-election does not apply to the vice president either. It only applies to the president. And re-election has a very definite meaning. That means you run for the same position. I think the any there, though it's not part of the constitutional records, the any there means at any time. Because for the vice president, she can cannot run for re-election immediately after. So the any there really is at any time. So that's my view. We respect the view of the constitutionalists, especially those who participated in the crafting of this constitution, but the rule is also very clear. If the constitution is clear using ordinary language, it will be interpreted with the ordinary meaning of those of the words used in the constitution.
All right, Attorney Domingo Cayosa, thank you for sharing your thoughts with us this morning. Attorney Cayosa of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines.